serve to glorify Jesus as my Lord. Paul's aim was that as long as he lived in the body, his life was to be a constant connection with Jesus. So it meant that every action was an act of praise. How is your life lived for Jesus? If you work in business, how will your work be done for Jesus? You have paperwork that you need to do. You have calls that you need to make. You have decisions that you need to enact. People that you need to meet with. What does it mean for every one of those actions to be done for Jesus? Now, so often when we use that term, what would Jesus do? We kind of think in terms of, well, I need to do the kind of things that Jesus did in the gospel. And there is truth to that. But the problem is, I always like to remind people that if we say, you know, how can I do the things that Jesus did, turning tables and yelling at tax collectors is a viable option, right? Jesus did all that kind of stuff. Maybe it's more important to say, instead of how can I do the things that Jesus did, if Jesus were to live my life, how would he do the things that I am faced to do? What would it mean for all my actions to be done as Jesus would do it? Now, again, it's not about strategy. It's not about efficiency. It's an internal acknowledgement. It's an internal discipline. Because the understanding that Christ is with us, to understand that you sit in your office or you sit at your home or you sit with your friend in the presence of Jesus, means that you will look at your decisions, your phone calls, your paperwork, your conversations, you will look at them differently. And internally, your spirit will begin to be formed closer and closer into the image of Christ. The big $10 theological word is Christ-likeness. That's what's going on. Because there is a difference in our life internally when we live in an attitude of it's all about me and one that says it's all about him. John the Baptist said, he must increase, I must decrease. Just after our passage, Paul talks about do nothing out of selfless ambition, but be humble and consider other people more than yourselves. And we can try to force ourselves to do that, you know, but it's kind of a contradiction to try to say, I am going to be so perfect that I'm going to be the humblest person in the world. Well, you can't force it. It has to be something that flows out of you, out of your internal rootedness in Jesus. To do things for Jesus means that we will engage all the activities in our life out of our love for God. They will be expressions of our love for God and God's love for us and for all people. So it doesn't matter what it is. Our involvement in those things are informed by the presence of Jesus. With Christ, in Christ, and for Christ. When our internal life is formed in the manner we find that our outward life begins to change. It means that some of the spiritual activities that we may find hard in our life, you know, the prayers, loving our enemies, forgiving our neighbors, they will begin to fall into place. They will be a little bit more easy than before. We will find that places of fear and anxiety begin to diminish and quiet down. We will be able to live out Jesus' words, don't be anxious about tomorrow. Do not fear, I am with you. You know, we talk about God's love and God's grace and the peace that passes all understanding and all the blessings of God. And sometimes we may internally question, you know, why don't I ever experience that half as deep as it sounds like I should? Well, we're going to start to. All those things that we talk about, they will begin to be seen and felt in our lives. Why? Not because we're doing the stuff that we need to be doing, but because we are opening that deep, that heart-filled, that that soul deep inner chamber of our lives, we are unlocking it and opening it to his presence. And a great time to start that is now. As you sit here, or as you're going to stand and you're going to sing the anthem, and as you sit and as you listen to the anthem, do it with Jesus. Sing with Jesus. Listen with him. Listen in him. Listen for him. As we get into our prayers, try to pray from that deepest inner place that you can, not just about reading names on the bulletins or the form in our book, but pray inwardly from deep within your heart. As we walk through the Eucharist and we enter into that place where we outwardly take bread and wine, don't just reach out with hands and lips, but make that time a time of internal, inward communion and devotion. In her book, Experiencing the Depths of Jesus Christ, Madame Guyon writes, "The Lord will meet you in your spirit." It was St. Augustine who once said that he had lost so much time in the beginning of his Christian experience in trying to find the Lord outwardly rather than turning inwardly. Once your heart has been turned inwardly before the Lord, you will have an impression of his presence. You will be able to notice his presence more acutely because your outer senses have now become calm and quiet. The Lord gives you the experience of enjoying his presence. He touches you, and his touch is so delightful that more than ever, you are drawn inwardly to him. I invite you to bow your heads as we pray. Almighty Lord, we thank you so much that our lives are lived with you, that our lives are lived in you, and that you call us to live our lives for you. As we turn inwardly and as we unlock that deep place in ourselves, in our souls, that place where we keep the deepest fears that we have, our deepest hopes, our deepest longings, as we open up that place, we ask you to come and make your presence known. Not in outward signs and manifestations, but an inward acknowledgement of your presence with us and for us. Bathe us in your love and in your grace so that we are immersed in it and live our lives in it. For the glory of your name we pray. Amen.